Welcome to this webinar. I'm Nick Hardiker. I'm Associate Dean for Research and Enterprise in the School of Human and Health Sciences at the University of Huddersfield, and I'm also Professor of Nursing and Health Informatics. I'm absolutely delighted and proud as punch, actually, to welcome you to this afternoon's event, Nursing Research Matters, Learning from COVID-19. Our school, the School of Human and Health Sciences, is the largest at the University of Huddersfield. Perhaps unsurprisingly, we deliver education and we do research in a number of areas relating particularly to health and social care. But this obviously includes nursing, and we're really proud to be hosting this event, which is being delivered in partnership with NHS England. This event will give just a small snapshot of research in nursing that's been carried out throughout the COVID-19 pandemic. Since the very early stages of the pandemic, nurses have played a key role in its prevention and management, but maybe less visibly, nurses have also been conducting really important research, research that's resulting in new interventions, new ways to deliver care, research that's helping us to understand better the experiences of patients and carers, and importantly, the impact on the nursing workforce. Over the past year, Ruth May, the Chief Nursing Officer for England, and a team at NHS England have been collating research into a portfolio, which demonstrates what we already know, that nursing research matters. This impressive portfolio is available via the webpage for this event. I think we as a profession should all celebrate and take pride in our achievements. We'll see a small slice of the research, this research today. We'll put a link link to the portfolio in the chat. We're also joined today. We're joined by four amazing speakers who are making a significant contribution to research in nursing. Firstly, Ann-Louise Caress is Professor of Health Services Research and Director of the Centre for Applied Research in Health here at the University of Huddersfield. Today, Anne will be exploring the experiences of people who are shielding from COVID-19. Secondly, Carl Thompson is Chair in Applied Health Research and Dame Kathleen Raven Chair in Clinical Research at the University of Leeds and Honorary Professor at the University of East Anglia and University of Alberta, Canada. Carl will focus on COVID-19 contact tracing for care homes. David Richards is Professor of Mental Health Services Research at the Universities of Exeter and Western Norway. David will talk about his work that's evaluating a guideline for the nursing care of hospital patients with COVID-19. And finally, Rebecca Lawton is Professor in Psychology of Healthcare at the University of Leeds and Bradford Institute of Health Research. Rebecca will be looking at the impact of nurse redeployment during the pandemic. We won't be taking a break between speakers, but we will be bringing them all back together after their short talks to discuss issues raised by their research. Please pose any questions, make any comments using the Q&A function at the bottom of your screen. Unfortunately, although Ruth May was billed to join us in person, she's unable to join us live today. She had intended to be here, not just to introduce the event, but for the whole session, but unfortunately she has been called away. I guess it comes with the job. She's naturally disappointed that she can't be here, but she sent a short message for us all, which we'll now share. Roll VT. I've always wanted to say that.
Hello, my name is Ruth, Chief Nursing Officer for England. And thank you for allowing me to join you today. It's a big day. It's a day that you're coming together as research leads, researchers, to have a conversation, to celebrate the work that you have all been doing during this last 15 or so months. It has been a hard year. It's been a year where we have come together as nurses, midwives and care workers across the whole globe to respond to coronavirus. It's been, whilst a hard year, a year that has been full of pride too, that we've been able to see the expertise and experience that nurses have been able to give to COVID. And that includes you. That includes you as research experts. And I'm delighted today that we are launching the research portfolio. A portfolio that is a collation of much of the nursing research contribution to COVID, and thank you to you all for contributing to that. Finally, I want to say thank you. Thank you individually and collectively for the work that you've done over this last 15 months, and I know that you'll be going on to do into the future. Your contribution to COVID through nursing research, I value. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Perhaps you realise from this message quite how important the research agenda is to her, and it's really wonderful to have the Chief Nursing Officer's support. So let's move on to the reason we're all here today. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, my colleague, Professor Ann Caress, and I invite Ann to take the stage. Ann.
Hello. Hi. Thanks, Nick. Thank you for that introduction. Let's just share my screen with you all. Okay. So I'm delighted to have the opportunity to share some of the findings from our study with you. Thank you very much to the Chief Nursing Officer and NHS England for giving me that opportunity. Shielding has affected millions of people worldwide who are clinically extremely vulnerable. In the UK alone, 2.2 million people initially in the first wave ended up being identified as requiring shielding. And that, of course, has been extended recently. So I think it's really important that we have some insight into what it's been like for those individuals. Just to tell you a little bit about the study. We recruited our participants through 14 UK-wide charities and patients' organisations and one NHS specialist cancer hospital. We did have one additional patient organisation and two further hospitals we'd hoped to recruit through, but unfortunately we didn't get the ethics and governance in place before the survey had to close. So we got responses from 1,423 people who were shielding, and we had a separate survey for family members. They were unmatched family members, and we got 383 responses from those. We are undertaking focus groups and interviews, sorry, the focus of the survey rather, is on the experiences, concerns and support needs of individuals, and also on their views about when shielding should stop for themselves and from the government perspective. We collected our data using an anonymous online survey, and we collected data just after the end of the first lockdown, so from early May to the end of July. We've done one interview sub-study so far, that's with people with rheumatoid arthritis, and data are being analysed from that at the moment, and we hope that we're going to be able to undertake some more interview sub-studies in the coming months. So here's a few headline findings from the total sample. It's true to say that nobody was delighted about the idea of shielding. However, the vast majority recognised that it was necessary for them. So you can see here, three quarters considered it to be necessary. There were, however, some aspects of shielding that were particularly difficult for individuals, and they related largely to maintaining physical distance or isolating inside the home. So that was things like having a bathroom to themselves, having a bedroom, sleeping separately from others, eating separately from others, and avoiding contact in areas like, for example, the kitchen. Shielding also affected various aspects of individuals' daily lives, and two that were particularly affected were their mood and their physical activity. And you can see here, you know, sizable proportions of the sample, more than half in the case of physical activity, felt it was worse. And that's important because maintaining, you know, good mood and good physical activity is important for everybody. But for some conditions, especially, for example, rheumatoid arthritis, maintaining physical activity levels is really important to keeping the condition well controlled. Information giving was an area that was problematic, and again, sizable proportions of the sample identified this as being inadequate and too late in being provided. To be fair to information providers, of course, it was a really dynamic situation. Even who was required to shield initially in the first wave when we were collecting data was uncertain, so it's perhaps not surprising, but that's something certainly that it would be a lesson to learn for the future. And about a third of the sample had consciously chosen not to follow some aspects of shielding guidance, and I'll give you some examples of exactly what the areas that related to later on. More people were satisfied than dissatisfied with the support that they received from various organisations, and they'd had contact with the NHS, with local authorities, with patients' organisations. However, food parcels were a particularly problematic area, and there was kind of general issues about the quality of what was being provided, but also some issues for people with special dietary needs. And again, I'll give you a couple of illustrations of that later on in the presentation. We asked people about what they would do if they were required to continue shielding. Of course, at that point, we weren't sure whether that was going to happen. It's actually happened. And indeed, for some individuals, it's still a recommendation. Most people said they would do it, albeit often reluctantly. But a feature of that was that individuals commonly said, but I would nuance it, I would individualise it. There were some things I would do, there were some things I wouldn't do. However, there was a subset of individuals for whom continuing shielding, they said, would be just impossible. And that was largely related to work or financial or caring responsibilities. So people were saying things like, you know, I simply can't stay off work any longer. I've been struggling to shield anyway because I've got a care of an elderly parent. And some would say things like, it's just not fair on the children. So, you know, people had wider considerations. We asked people about what they thought about how the government should handle the exit strategy. And of course, again, bear in mind, this was just after the first wave. There was a wide range of responses. A very small proportion of people, kind of 1-2%, were saying nothing different, we should just be treated like everybody else. And then the most common response was the one that you see here, that the government should wait until there's been a marked reduction in new UK cases and deaths. But again, people really were often saying, I would do it, but oh, I would be really distressed having to do it. People making some really powerful statements about how I'd cry, I'd feel depressed, I'd feel even more depressed. So it was clear that for some individuals, it would take a toll having to do that. So what I'm going to do now is present a couple of vignettes from two of the clinical conditions that were represented in the sample. The first of those is people with kidney problems. We had a quite high number of people responding in the sample with kidney conditions. They were a mixture of people who'd had a transplant or who were receiving dialysis. Of course, for the people receiving a transplant, daily life other than medications is relatively normal. They don't have to, many of them don't have to follow a special diet. For people who are receiving dialysis, the majority of those in our sample were people on hemodialysis rather than peritoneal dialysis, and that meant that they had to break shielding 3 times a week in order to go for in-centre dialysis. In terms of the sample, it was reasonably typical of what you'd expect to see of a renal population other than in terms of ethnicity. Our sample was very, not just the renal populations, across the board, was very white British, which is a limitation of the study. And that's really because, given the time constraints that we've faced, we weren't able to produce specific language versions of our questionnaires. We are hoping that we might be able to address that a little bit in interview studies. And I just want to thank the organisations that helped us recruit, the NKF, the National Kidney Federation, Kidney Care UK, and the Manchester Royal Infirmary Kidney Patients Association. The other subsample I'm going to present is of people with cystic fibrosis. We had a smaller number of those. But the reason I'm particularly keen to present for them is because for people with cystic fibrosis, many aspects of shielding are quite familiar to them because they're already required, because of the nature of their condition, to limit their social contact, to avoid getting in crowds and so on and so forth. So for them, the challenges were rather different. They're also a younger age group, so many of them face challenges around working and young families. But one of the big issues for people with cystic fibrosis that's come out through, for example, the Cystic Fibrosis Trust helpline, is that people found the loss of independence that having to shield imposed on them really quite challenging. Again, in terms of the sample, fairly typical of what you'd expect to see in this population, as you'd expect, a younger age group, and again, very white British, which was true of the whole sample. And another thank you to our partner, the Cystic Fibrosis Trust. So comparing the two samples in terms of how easy or difficult they found shielding, you can see there was a bit of a contrast there. In part, that seems to have been explained by the older age group of the people with kidney problems. Fewer of those were working, for example, and few of them have younger children at home. But also, there was that issue for the people with cystic fibrosis of just them finding that shielding really challenged their kind of independence and their identity. In terms of mood, you can see here that, like the rest of the sample, more people felt their mood was worse than it had been before shielding. And you can see that the people with cystic fibrosis, that was particularly the case. 63% of them, that's, you know, nearly two-thirds of them were saying their mood was worse. And that may be consistent with there being a younger age group. Across the board, studies not specific to health conditions, you know, population-based studies, have been finding that younger people's mood is worse than older people's in relation to the pandemic. So here are some examples of where people had chosen to not follow aspects of shielding guidance. Again, you can see sizable proportions of the population, but more so in the people with cystic fibrosis. And I think that is probably because people with cystic fibrosis have lived all their lives with these kind of limitations, so may feel a little bit more confident in navigating them. The main aspects that people decided not to follow related to physical activity, maintaining social contact, and for caring responsibilities. The one that slightly troubles me is some individuals saying that they were happy to go out meeting with others as they were well. And of course, we know now that asymptomatic transmission of COVID is possible. So there was a little bit of kind of risky behaviour going on for some individuals there. These are a few data extracts relating to food parcels and why people thought they were unsuitable. And you can see here from the data extracts, the main reasons were because they either contained things that were contraindicated for individuals, or they didn't contain things that people needed, like enough protein or enough calories. There were some general criticisms that the food packages were of poor quality or they were inadequate. And that actually has been leveled in more general terms. At food packages, both for shielding, but also things like, for example, food banks. But to be fair to the organisations involved, it's really, really difficult to provide fresh food when you're providing food packages because it's so perishable. So I think that, you know, there are some real challenges, but I think one of the learning points for the future will be if this kind of support is provided again, that there maybe need to be some kind of nuancing of it and some involvement of patient organisations to ensure that it better meets needs. Looking now at when people thought shielding should end, again, you can see for these two groups, slightly more so than the whole sample, they thought that it should be not until there was a marked reduction in UK COVID cases and deaths. Bear in mind, when we were collecting the data, it was relatively early in the pandemic after the first wave. Vaccines were still only just being developed. You know, there wasn't a vaccine at that point. So I suspect if we repeated the survey now, we might find that vaccines would play a more predominant role in people's responses. So that's the end of my presentation. It's just a snippet. We've got lots and lots of data, particularly around people's concerns and exit strategies that I'd love to be able to share with you, but obviously in a short presentation can't. But feel free to contact me if you want to. I just want to say thank you to all our partner organisations. Thank you to the Chief Nurse for giving me the opportunity to do this. Particular thanks to Nick and the University of Huddersfield. This was an unfunded project. We tried for funding and didn't get it, and the university still allowed us to go ahead and supported us in doing so. And just finally, to dedicate my presentation to Donal O'Donoghue. He was a member of our team and a towering figure in the renal world, and he sadly died with COVID in January of this year, and he's very, very much missed. So thank you. Over to you, Nick.
Thanks so much, Anne. Important lessons, not just for the current situation, but for the future. Lessons around mood worsening, for example, people not following as any aspects of the guidance, the importance of tailorability of the things that we're doing. So thanks so much, really, really interesting. Please, if you have any comments or questions for Anne, please post them. Or if you have comments about the webinar in general, then please post those also. Hopefully we've resolved some of the sound issues now, but please, even if you think they're superficial comments, please post those. Thank you. So we'll move on now to our next speaker, Professor Carl Thompson. Carl, could jump on the stage, please.
Hi, Nick. OK, Can you hear me?
Yeah, that's fine. Go ahead.
Fantastic. I'll share my screen and then we'll get going with the presentation. So thank you, everyone. Thanks for the opportunity to tell you all about the contact trial. This is a feasibility and definitive cluster randomized trial of wearable devices for enabling contact tracing in care homes. It's funded by the NIHR, the COVID Recovery and Learning Fund, and the Health Technology Assessment Programme. So why a trial of wearable devices? Well, about 70% of residents in care homes for older people have some form of cognitive or memory problem, and staff have many, many contacts in a day, and contact between staff and residents, if you think about it in social care, is absolutely unavoidable. It's an essential part of caring. And contact tracing alongside vaccination and infection control procedures is a key component in all of our efforts, communal efforts to control the virus in the communities in which we all live, except care homes. So the reality is that traditional contact tracing using interviews and recall from individuals finishes at the care home door. I mean, I don't need to tell you how badly care homes have been affected by the pandemic. About 40,000 UK care home residents, elderly care home residents, have died in the pandemic, and care homes have been disproportionately affected. But of greater consequence for all residents in homes has been the deprivation of liberty and restrictions on visiting that have characterised the kind of sector and policy response to COVID-19. We hope that by making contact tracing and better information a feasible proposition for homes, then truly informs management of transmissible disease, not just COVID, but also other diseases which kill older residents, norovirus, gastroenteritis, seasonal influenza, then it will add to the armory of interventions that homes and home managers have available to help manage infections, but also to open up and welcome communities and families back into homes. So how does it work? So we take data from wearables which come into contact with each other. I don't know if you can see me on the screen or not, but there's a wearable there next to a watch. We take wearables coming into contact with each other and between wearables and location devices. So our contact is 2 meters or 15 minutes, or it can be less or more than 2 meters, or any time frame. We'll talk about that in a second. And that's captured locally and transmitted via a secure radio network to our commercial partners, Microshare, and their servers. Large amounts, huge amounts of raw data, which is captured by that, and then that raw data is then captured by the Clinical Trials Research Unit, who download that, and they combine that data with information from the research team on each home. So variables such as implementation-related variables and vaccination rates and so on. And that's combined with data from the homes as well in terms of staffing and other variables. And then all of that is cleaned, ready for analysis onto a platform called Veridata, which allows us to undertake various forms of analysis, which we can use as a basis for feedback to homes. And we feed back to homes in a number of ways. So what we do is we produce a routine automated feedback every month on patterns and trends of contacts. And we basically, for those of you who know about knowledge transfer, we're pushing information out to homes. Homes can also request information from a team, so that can be for a management decision, or more commonly for a positive case in the home or an outbreak, and we can produce lists of contacts, where those contacts happened and how often and so on. And that's for pull in push-pull knowledge transfer, for those of you who dabble in that world. And it's an important one. We support the homes with a weekly phone call and a bespoke WhatsApp group to each home in which we help them interpret the data that they're seeing and the patterns and trends and stimulate conversations with the home. And you'll see why that's important in a second. And the aim is that we hope that this new and valuable information is designed to improve infection control, planning decisions and behaviours, such as zoning in homes and being able to look at breaches and non-compliance with that. And but more broadly, to help homes link contact data to wider managerial issues around quality and environment. So we're really keen to evaluate this in a fair and rigorous way, which is really important. And if you think about infection control and the behaviours which shape it, they're all influenced by the homes in which we live. So we did a cluster randomised trial where the homes themselves are the clusters. So at the moment, we've set up doing initial feasibility work with two independent homes, medium-sized independent homes in Leeds. We're hoping to extend that feasibility work to four more homes in Yorkshire and the East Midlands. We've had to extend the feasibility phase because we've refined and improved already some key elements of a trial procedures around recruitment of staff and residents, looking at different forms of technology, so cards versus wearable key fobs, and also done quite a lot of work around reporting what and how to report and work with homes. And we want to get that right and to optimise that before we roll out to the main trial later in the summer, in which we're going to randomise 64 homes in Yorkshire and the East Midlands to receive either the intervention arm of a trial of the devices and feedback, or a test and trace as usual control. We're using normalization process theory to help us predict and explain the adoption and use of the devices and the feedback. We're also undertaking a cost effectiveness analysis from the perspective of the homes, including the implementation costs. And what I'd like to highlight is just a whole host of work which we're doing with engineering colleagues, looking at variables such as air quality and ventilation, which have emerged as key issues in the approaches of homes to infection control, which weren't there before the pandemic. So the trial is already showing some early promise in the two feasibility homes in terms of working as it should. We've got two feasibility homes. In the first home, we've got almost 100% of staff and 100% of residents wearing the devices, well-supported weekly feedback and well-supported information use. In the second, not so much. About half the staff and about 40% of residents initially took up the technology. That is improving, but it's been slow going and hard going. So the kind of take home here is that despite it being obvious to researchers that not all social care staff are convinced by COVID-19 and interventions to tackle it, and that surprised us a little bit. But that said, the technology, data and analysis, though, is shining a light on the complex social network of nodes, people and edges, relationships, interactions that make up a care home. We've been able to generate at speed just a few minutes from taking a phone call saying there's been a positive case, identifying the case, and then being able to furnish the home with a list of contacts of how often that happened, who those contacts, the type of contact they are, and where that happened in the home. And that's new information which the home would not have had previously. Importantly, we're able to examine the micro networks of contacts that homes may wish to work with to optimise their infection control. So this slide here is just showing six very distinct networks in a home over 3 days. And what's really interesting, apart from the relative separation of staff and residents, is that staff member number 8 here, who links together this staff network, well-developed staff network, with this developed resident network, was actually an activities coordinator in the home who kind of was off the radar of the home, but more importantly, wasn't necessarily adhering in such a strict and protocolised way to PPE testing and other elements of the home's infection control regime. And we were able to show that to the home and to work with them to give them a flavour of new information which would allow them to make, well, hopefully more informed decisions about how they manage their infection risk. So the driving force of the trial was infection, because we were commissioned early on in the pandemic. And it's important that, as well as infection, we're aware of the role of contact data in shining a much broader light on care home, aspects of care home life. So the HS&DR, the NIHR's HS&DR programme, funded work by Karen Spilsbury and her team, examining the relationship between quality and staffing in care homes. And what's emerged out of that work is a really clear relationship between interaction with staff and residents and where and how quality is generated. And very preliminary results from our home suggest that contact as a proxy for this kind of really important generative mechanism could be really A, important, and B, possibly improved. So we've got, what we've got here is data from a single home in the, and this is really preliminary data, we've only been going really since January, that the, and the green columns here are contacts of more than a minute and less than 15 minutes, and the red are Public Health England definitions of a contact, so that's 15 minutes or more, 2 metres or less from one of our homes. And the most common contacts that you can see are between staff and staff over here rather than staff and residents, which surprised us, to be honest. But the explanation that's offered by the home was that staff are often doubling up on care tasks, and that's what we're seeing. But actually, that doesn't explain the discrepancy between the two red columns here. So what that's done, importantly, is stimulate a conversation with the home about whether that relative balance is the kind of balance that they want. So when we talk about the unintended consequences of responses to COVID-19, it may be that the pandemic is even shaping this really most fundamental of aspects of home, which is just interaction between staff and residents. So we quite literally can recast contact almost as quality time. We can see that as well as the frequency of staff spending time with residents, we can actually see that when it comes to duration of time, the staff are spending longer with each other than they are with residents as well. I mean, again, this is seriously preliminary data, and the purpose of showing you this is to give you a flavour of how rich the data can be and the extensive nature of it, but also its role in just stimulating developmental formative conversations with homes about their relationship between contact and management. So pulling all together some early lessons that we've picked up. I mean, the first lesson I think we've learned is that implementation, despite having a team full of complex intervention developers from a trials unit and implementation scientists, it really isn't a given, even in a pandemic context. What makes perfect sense to us didn't to frontline staff. Concepts like tracking, tracing, reporting, even in the context of a pandemic, were not always viewed positively. We've encountered resistance and pushback. We've got two homes so far and two very, very different experiences. I think the second thing I want to flag up is that, and this is probably ironic in a research seminar, but innovation without research would have been much, much easier. If we'd simply set up a company and sold this to the sector, we could probably all have retired by now, the demand was so great. The framework of governance and ethics and approvals and contracting that was a backdrop for the research has not been our friend. It's been very, very tough, and I think in this space, lots of people are exploiting the fact that non-research-based innovation is much, much easier. But that said, there is a huge reasons to be optimistic. We're going to have loads and loads of rich, dynamic network data that represents an open access resource for researchers to be able to explore and test ideas and theory at a scale and a depth that we've really not had anywhere else in the world in social care. And I think for modellers of infections and those who are interested in quality and risk and work and relationships and environments in homes, contact studies are going to offer something very, very valuable. But I think most of all, we really hope that the contact trial facilitates the opening up of homes and residents and their staff being part of the wider communities to which they belong and have been denied for so long. So I've only scratched the surface of a contact study and its potential and what we're about. We've only really been going for a couple of months in truth, but if you'd like to know more and you'd like to take part, or you know of a home that might consider like to take part, then please contact me. I think my details are on the flyers and so on, and we'd love to talk to you. Thank you very much.
Thanks so much, Carl. Another excellent presentation, raising really interesting issues. I think from the outset, I was thinking what anathema it is to nursing for contact to be a bad thing. It's quite interesting the pandemic's revealed. The tension that you described to some extent between doing or implementing and explaining or discovering, and that the tension that always exists in a research kind of context. But thanks so much. We'll move on now. There are some questions actually kind of lining up for the speakers, which I'm delighted about. So please keep the questions coming. And we'll move straight on now to Professor David Richards, our next speaker, who's going to deliver his presentation. David, over to you.
Thank you, Nick, and thank you to NHS England for organising this with you and for helping us disseminate and get some interest in research in COVID for nurses. Here is my screen share. I'm now going to talk about a guideline for the nursing care of hospital patients with COVID-19. And here, as you can see, a lot of colleagues, a lot of collaborators from NHS and university, and also people places. So I'm going to start with a quote. It's a quote from a patient, somebody who's been in hospital after COVID. And this quote you may remember, you may recognise. It's hard to find the words to express my debt to the NHS for saving my life. I want to thank the many nurses whose care has been so astonishing, and I particularly like this last bit, because for every second of the night they were watching, they were thinking, they were caring and making the interventions I need. I think that's a marvellous description. I don't know who wrote this, but I know who said it. And it in fact was, of course, the boss. So if you remember last year, this time last year, Boris Johnson was in hospital and name-checked quite emotionally and said these things about nursing care that he received. Because for me, I think COVID care is nursing care. Not to say that there aren't important medical advances and pharmaceutical advances, but let's be straight. Most care that people receive in hospital is nursing care, and it is that care that contributes more than anything to their outcomes in hospital. Our aims was to develop and evaluate the impact on patient experience. They thought that was particularly important. And these other things are a nursing care protocol specifically addressing fundamental care requirements of people in hospital with the SARS-CoV-2 virus. That's the real name for it. It's not called COVID-19. People who were not invasively ventilated, they may have been invasively ventilated, but we were interested in finding out what people's experiences of care were, and you need to be conscious to be able to report that. We were also interested in comparing the effects of using the clinical protocol to care as usual on nurses' moral distress. Moral distress is basically the gap between what you want to do as a professional and what you can do. The fundamentals of care model have been around for around about 10 years or so, or perhaps it's been around since Florence Nightingale, but it is a description of the things that you and I require and value very much when we're in hospital. I would absolutely, as a patient myself on a few occasions, I would endorse physical, relational and psychosocial needs. There are some essential needs to do with hygiene, my comfort, my safety, my eating and drinking and so on. There is the relationship that I have with my healthcare providers, and then the psychosocial needs at the bottom. These are the ones we chose. It's not the full model, Alison Kitson's model of fundamental care, but they're the ones that tend to rise to the top, and they're the ones that we chose when we're trying to do guideline development. We developed the guideline in a very rapid way, because we didn't have much time. Everything was done at warp speed in the research world, as you remember, after COVID appeared on the horizon. We did a rapid systematic review. We involved patients and members of the public, and we did a national nurse survey. We brought all that data together into consensus groups of nurses and patients, and out of that flew the intervention. The intervention consists of a guideline, some trigger posters, and an online educational resource, which I will go through a little later. The thing is, we are kind of new stuff already. And here's some quotes from the Canadians who experienced an outbreak of SARS in 2003 in Toronto, when it was imported there. They talked about the therapeutic nurse-client relationship needing time and being impeded by masks, gloves and gowns. They talked about visitors and restrictions on visitors because visitors are involved in many aspects of care. And they talked about patients feeling abandoned. So these quotes are out there in the ether, but nothing had been done with them. And nurses were as unprepared as everybody else for the emergence of a major pandemic, even though these kind of anecdotes were around. So when we did a review, we found that we had 64 articles that were published, that had been published, spanning five pandemics. Only 19 of them were empirical research. So the vast majority of stuff was like what I just showed you, which was commentaries, editorials and guidance, but much of the guidance wasn't based on any data. And we confirmed that there is no existing guideline for the nursing care of patients in a pandemic. By the nursing care, I mean the fundamental nursing care of patients. You will see why this is so important in a minute. The review showed that there were barriers to delivering fundamental care, and they were probably of no surprise to many of you here. I'm sure you yourselves have been involved in the nursing care of people with the virus in hospital. Wearing personal protective equipment, staffing, that's both the roles that you're required to adopt often without any preparation, and the workload as well. The infection control procedures themselves creating barriers to care. A great fear of contracting or transmitting the disease, and there was a bunch of other challenges to do with the burden on individual nurses and the support that they required. Nurses adapted in really roughly four thematic ways. Nurses adapted their communication, and this is in the reported literature, this is in the published literature. They adapted the way they organised care, and adaptations were put in place to support nursing staff. And there was a fair bit of literature on nurse leadership, but there's almost no or very poor quality empirical evidence for the effect of these adaptations on patient experience, care quality or treatment outcomes. In fact, of all those 64 articles, only two collected data from patients themselves or their significant others. So we didn't have any evidence to base our practice on. When we looked at the survey, we surveyed about 1,000 nurses who had been involved in caring for patients in hospital in wave one, that was March 2000 onwards. And in terms of those three fundamental care areas I just talked about, one of the five, there's eight sort of top five, top there are eight because they occur in one of the three areas. Wearing PPE, the severity of patients' condition, the inability to take items in and out of isolation rooms. You guys will know about that. You know about if you forget something, it's a real pain to get out of PPE and back into it. A lack of time spent with patients, echoing what we heard from the literature. Lack of presence from other services. This was interesting. When whole wards suddenly became infection control environments, nurses were reporting that many other allied healthcare professionals were no longer present in the wards. There was a real lack of knowledge, as Ann Caress said, about the virus. In the early days, there was insufficient stock. And of course, there was a reluctance to spend time with patients for fear of catching it. And we know that was a real fear, an important fear, given death rates and morbidity rates in some of our colleagues. We also asked about miscare. And this is really interesting. So what effect did these barriers have on the care for patients with the virus in hospital? And what we found, if we asked about physical care, is that roughly a third of all nurses who answered our survey said that care was worse for these patients compared to ones that they were used to caring for. There was one thing that steps out there. You can see the red bar in mobility. So more than half of all nurses who responded to the survey said that mobility care was worse for patients with COVID in hospital than the patients they've normally been looking after. And I think we can think about that, obviously, how that might be, you know, nurses and patients are frightened of moving through breathlessness and so on. They're nursed often in a prone position, and you can't just pop out down the ward to go to the loo. So mobility was really impacted significantly. a completely different picture when you look at relational care, in that almost all elements of relational care are rated by most nurses as worse for these patients than for the patients they're used to caring for. Communicating with relatives was worse, non-verbal communication was worse, talking and listening was worse, and just below 50%, but still the majority of respondents were saying that establishing a relationship with patients was more difficult and was missed in these patients compared to others. When we look at the final area, psychosocial care, nurses reported treating patients with the same level of dignity and respect, and but that emotional well-being, anxiety and depression was delivered less well than in patients they would be expecting to see normally and look after normally. So we have some deficits in care. And from those deficits, we also asked the nurses, well, what did you do about it? What were the adaptations you made? And we identified 26 potential strategies to address physical, relational and psychosocial nursing care barriers. They're implemented, we will show you in a minute, a printed guideline, an online guideline as well, trigger reminder posters, an education program and leadership for ward managers and senior nurses. So here you go, this is what the clinical guideline looks like. And I'll just expand the summary, the quick guide. You will notice that I take full responsibility for laying this out as COVID. I'm afraid I had a very sleepless night one night, and it just came to me that how could we present this in a way? So we've got communication, organisation, values, interventions, and I could have put D for depression, but the emotional impact of COVID is more than just depression. So it's do remember mental health and emotional well-being. All this is trying to help people remember how to deal with these adaptations, how you're going to grab these things and make them work for you. Communication is not just with patients, it's with significant others, between patients, between nurses and other members of the care team. All these things were impacted, and nurses gave us some really good suggestions about how to overcome these things. The organisation of fundamental nursing care, values really came out strongly from our patients. Most of those nurses thought that they values part of care had been done pretty much the same. Some of our patients did not agree. Interventions, specific care interventions, for example, how do you help somebody with their mobility needs? And we've got mental health, and also very importantly, management and leadership came across as very strongly implicated in caring for patients with COVID. We produced an online education resource. This is from an organisation called Future Learn. Future Learn is a spin-out from the Open University, so they do know a thing or two about online learning. So this is our course. It's available for those people implementing the guideline. And it's not just death by PowerPoint. Let me reassure you on that here. It's full of really good interactional videos. So we've got videos here from Kara, from a nurse, from a patient, and from a scientist. That's Barak Pankania, who is a senior clinical lecturer at the University in Exeter. You often see him on the news. He's an epidemiologist. Extremely helpful person. So here's a scientist on our team who presented this data. So anybody wanting to overcome those barriers, to use some of the innovations, goes on here and listens to people talking about things. It's very, very powerful stuff. We're now doing a clinical trial. It's a cluster randomized trial because, like Carl's thing, if you change practice in one place, you can't just randomize patients to nurses to receive the intervention or not, because obviously we're talking about team-based interventions and nurses changing their behavior. So in our intervention sites, they're hospitals, our care as usual sites are other hospitals. Patients with COVID admitted for more than 72 hours so that they can actually have some experience of nursing care and report on it, and nurses caring for those patients. Our primary outcomes are really important, is patient experience. What do patients experience in terms of nursing care? And then for nurses, what about their moral distress? Does the guideline bring their care closer to where they'd like it to be and reduce their moral distress? So it's a guideline developed by nurses for nurses, and it's grounded in real-world experience of both nurses and patients. It's not something that a bunch of clever academics or stupid academics have parachuted into the NHS. It's built from literature, it's built from nurses' experiences and the voices of patients and carers. And I think it's quite a rare example of a clinical trial in nursing care. I think we don't see too many of those, so we're really happy to do it. But as Carl said, it's been an extremely difficult trial to undertake. I'll put it out there and you can feel what you want to feel. We were not regarded as a priority when it came to distributing clinical research nurse resources. So the body that was in charge of prioritising studies did not prioritise this trial. That was the biggest difficulty we faced. Equally, pressures on nurses and rapid changes in admission rates, as you can see. We've had loads of stories I can tell you. For example, just about as we're about to start one site as a trial, everybody in the senior management team and associated got COVID and had to go sick or isolate. We had another site that was ready to go and they started doing asymptomatic testing and 20% of their nurses had to be sent home. That makes it very difficult to do trials. Recently, of course, we've had very welcome rapid changes in admission rates, so that we're now struggling actually to recruit patients because our participant levels are so low. Of course, that's absolutely to be desired, but it makes it very difficult to do a trial. So we do need your help. And if anybody out there would like to email us, we need some more NHS sites for the trial. We need them as quickly as we can. We're continuing the trial now until October. But we absolutely need some more sites so that we can really test this guideline and come up with robust findings. There it is. There's my partners. It's led from the University of Exeter, but we've got, as you can see, Marsden, Nottingham, Leicester, NHS sites in Devon, Nottingham and elsewhere, and the University of Southampton. And so, yes, thank you very much for listening. And I look forward to your questions.
Thanks. Thank you so much. Another excellent presentation. I think it's always interesting to hear from nurses about their own perceptions about the care that they're giving. And actually, the literature review, I was reflecting on the portfolio, the current portfolio, which is referenced in the chat, and how impressive that is as a body of work. I think the nursing community very quickly mobilised into a strong research community. So thanks so much, David. There will be some questions. I suspect a question about research is coming on. And the difficulties. So thanks so much. We'll move on now to our final speaker of the afternoon, Professor Rebecca Lawton. Rebecca, could you, thank you. Over to you.
Thank you very much and good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for inviting me to talk today. I'm going to talk to you about determining the impact of nurse redeployment during COVID-19. And I'm lucky enough as a psychologist, a professor of the psychology of healthcare at the University of Leeds, to work very closely with a number of nursing colleagues. And in addition to that, working with people in the fields of management studies, ethics and work psychology. And this project is a culmination of those different disciplines coming together to address this very important issue that many of you will be familiar with. I want to start just by telling you a little bit about how we came to devise the project and the particular research questions we're asking in the project before moving on to talk about some of the initial findings. Before I do that, though, I should say that this work was funded to start in October with a view that we would be able to kick off at that point because the pandemic would be waning. As we all know, that is not the case. So there have been some delays to the start of this project. And so what I'm going to report today are very preliminary findings from our research. But everybody we've spoken to has suggested to us that we should be disseminating our findings as we go. And through doing that, ensuring that people are offered an opportunity to input in how the research develops as we deliver this program of work until April 2022. So the first point is a very obvious one. I don't need to tell anybody that redeployment happened during the pandemic as a result of different needs across organisations in terms of nurse staffing. It happened with little time to plan or indeed knowledge of how to do redeployment effectively, fairly, and with a consideration of ethics. And my nursing colleagues who I was working with were repeatedly letting me know about how difficult redeployment was in the organisation. Many of them, many of my colleagues were redeployed from their research roles into a variety of different operational roles, COVID vaccine trial roles and other more frontline care. What we also identified as we started to look was that there is the evidence base in this area is lacking. And so there was really a need for a greater understanding of how to do redeployment, not only during a pandemic, but what we can learn from that process for redeployments more generally. Redeployment, as we all know, happens on a daily basis across our healthcare organisations. Around this time, I also came across an article on the ethics of redeployment, which was very interesting to me. And that was written by a colleague who's working closely with Oxford University Hospital. And so we invited him to be part of the team, thinking that it would be entirely relevant and appropriate to have an ethicist working alongside us and offering us a different disciplinary perspective on the work we were doing. And we were getting a lot of feedback through our contacts in our own healthcare organisation around the local challenges and anecdotal evidence indicating that there were multiple stressors for staff as they were redeployed, which involved sometimes the relational aspects, so losing local support networks when they were redeployed into new workplaces, new units, and also feelings of incompetence that some nurses experience as if they were starting back as a trainee in these new areas. But also we identified that some nurses were reporting some real positives of being redeployed in terms of understanding different roles, learning new things and developing new relationships with people who they wouldn't normally work with in the trust. We developed using multiple theories around job design theories, sense making, and as I say, the ethical theories we're referring to, a kind of baseline model that we were working with for our research. So we're in the process of generating the data, testing this model and developing this model, which essentially says people make redeployment decisions and there are processes that people go through in redeploying staff. Nurses then make sense of those processes and those redeployment decisions, and it's as a result of that sense making that things like their health and well-being are impacted, and whether the outcomes for work are positive or negative. And equally, those things around well-being and positive and negative job outcomes have implications for retention and turnover of staff and safety and performance of those nurses. So the aims of the research that we are conducting, and this research is funded by NIHR Health Services and Delivery, their COVID recovery scheme, was to gain a better understanding of the impact of redeployment during COVID-19 on nurse wellbeing, performance and retention. And we wanted to come at this from two angles. So the first work package is all around understanding how the process of redeploying nursing staff was managed prior to and during the COVID-19 crisis. And then the second work package is around understanding the nurses themselves and their experience of that redeployment and the associated impact that might have on their health and well-being, both positive and negative, their motivation, performance and turnover intentions. And we have recruited and are working closely with nursing PIs in three trusts, Bradford, Oxford and Royal London, to do this work. And those trusts were chosen for their different staff ethnicity, demographics and the experiences of those trusts, different experiences of the COVID-19 pandemic. So these are the methods we're employing for this study. In work package one, we're engaging in interviews with 33 nurse managers responsible for redeployment of staff. And we're also developing some findings from that and feeding that back to nurse managers in focus groups and getting their views on initial findings and anything further that they want to contribute as things have moved on over time and they themselves have learnt about redeployment and perhaps how to do that better. In work package two, we're conducting a longitudinal study with 60 nurses at 3 different time points. So in the early stages, we are asking nurses to complete a questionnaire and conducting an interview with them. That then the questionnaire is then repeated at month 4, and in month 11, which will be early next year, we'll have a follow-up questionnaire and interview. And all of this work is supported by our staff advisory group and conversations with patients, which we call community conversations. So the data collection to date, as I say, this study didn't get off the ground as anticipated in October last year. So there hasn't been a huge amount of data collection thus far, but I'm going to report early findings from Work Package 1, which is our study of nurse managers. And in total, we've recruited 22 nurse managers to this study so far. We're aiming for 33, as I said, and I'm going to report on those interviews conducted with 14 people across 2 trusts. One trust is only kicking off with recruitment this week. And work package 2, there's just some information about figures there, but I won't be referring to the findings from that study today. So some preliminary insights then from work package 1. I'm going to talk to you about some of the structural factors around redeploying staff and decision making within organisations. I'm going to talk to you about experiences of staff making redeployment decisions and also some early evidence of good practice in redeployment that we can all learn from. And one of the particular aims of this study is to really pick out where that good practice exists and to spread that. So in terms of structural factors, what we found was that the response to redeployment and the challenges of redeploying staff were very different in the organisations depending on what happened pre-COVID. So the sense making of nurses was very dependent on how redeployment happened before the COVID-19 pandemic happened. So in Trust A, redeployment was managed locally. People often felt that if they were the nurse to be redeployed, that they had drawn the short straw and wondered why it was them and perhaps why it was them again. And redeployment conversations in this trust did often involve some kind of conflict or a reluctance to be redeployed and quite difficult conversations with those people managing the staffing levels and nursing on the particular wards. During COVID-19 in this trust, decisions around redeployment tended to come from executives at a senior level and used largely a top-down approach, but the day-to-day redeployment was managed by staffing matrons. And unfortunately, the somewhat existing negative perceptions around redeployment were confounded during the pandemic. So the kind of impression that redeployment was the short straw was reinforced during this time. In Trust B, the situation was slightly different in that redeployment was generally managed locally, but there was a centralised pool when staffing levels became challenging that the wards and units could draw from when they needed additional staff. This meant that some staff were more likely to choose redeployment, be in that pool, because there were some bonuses, including extra pay associated with being in that pool. And therefore, minimal conflict was experienced and anticipated when managing redeployment, although that doesn't mean there was no conflict or challenges at all. So what happened during COVID-19 was that there was a ramping up of the existing redeployment structure, in essence the pool that existed. Key decisions around redeployment involved different levels of staff, and there was mostly a positive experience of redeployments in this trust. So what was the redeployment experience of those having to manage it? Well, senior nurses often reported in our interviews so far that they found making decisions around redeploying challenging, both professionally and emotionally. And the quotes on the right-hand side of that slide there, which I'll leave you to read, speak very much to that sense of these things being difficult situations to be in. They indicated understanding and empathising with nurses around redeployment, such as the toll that placing nurses in positions with large patient-to-nurse ratios and high acuity patients could have on staff wellbeing. And some nurses experienced challenges and conflict when communicating redeployment decisions to nurses that they were asking to redeploy into a new area. As I said, we have found some really good examples of good practice in the trust that we're working with, and these are some of them. Really listening to staff and learning lessons about redeployment, particularly in between waves, so that redeployment could be managed better or differently the next time around. Very clear decision making and communication of those decisions was really important, and that was felt by the managers themselves, but we're also picking that up in some of our early interviews in Work Package 2. If at all possible, keeping teams or smaller teams together when redeploying was really valuable. And redeploying for longer fixed periods of time so that staff knew how long they were going to be redeployed for, rather than infinite periods or day-to-day ad hoc redeployment, was seen as more positive. So as I say, these are only very preliminary findings and they may change as we move on and start recruiting from across all three trusts. But what we're hoping this research project will deliver is a better understanding of how to manage redeployment so that the benefits are maximised and the costs are minimised, that we can inform national and local redeployment policies. We do know that there are policies out there, the RCN has a policy on redeployment, but many of our nurse managers told us that this wasn't particularly helpful when they began the process of having to actually operationalise redeployment on the front line. That we hope to inform the development of guidance and training for managers tasked with redeploying the workforce and offer advice on the support and training needed for nurses who are redeployed. And that's it from me, but I really like to end by emphasising that I am the PI, the principal investigator, but part of a very large team of people who are contributing their efforts towards delivering this project. And please do feel free to tweet me or to email me if you have any questions after today. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rebecca, and thanks to all of the speakers. We're now we're going to go into a period of